morning sessions. You know, come tomorrow morning. I think you'll be blessed for that. And so I want to take this time and welcome Rick Osborne to the stage. So him and his wife Brenda are missionaries to Liberia. And so, brother, I'm just going to have you come up. We're going to show a video first, and we'll go from there. But we're glad you're here, and we're looking forward to seeing what you have for us.
May feel that you have been so wicked, so bad, that there is no hope for you to go to heaven. But verse 9 gives all of us a message of hope.
Literally die.
Okay. Well, we might too.
Literally.
Oh, I hate bridges anyway. I hate bridges. I hate them. Well, let's just hang on. Please get over this. Get over the bridge, will you? God,
dude. Cal would hate this.
Let's go. Quick. I can't look at this.
We're shaking that.
Oh, that's so good to get over that thing.
Thank you. What? No, 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 wait. You got midget?
Depends on which one he's going to cross. He's going to he's be on the log.
Good.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
We are going to have some question and answers, so we may need another mic. Let me just start off, and you can see that these people are happy. I know for myself, the first time I went to a third world country, that was actually in Haiti. And your first instinct, or at least mine was, and I believe most Americans' first instinct is, you feel so sorry for these people when you see the way they live and the shacks and the tin buildings, and you saw what the kids were playing. But they were having fun, weren't they? Until you realize and understand that's the only life they know. See, we're comparing it to our life. And so they do have joy, and they do laugh. But their days are pretty much filled with surviving as well. And again, that's the life they live, and they understand that. Liberia, you notice there was two interpreters there. The national language for Liberia is English. However, they have two kinds of English. They have what they call Liberian English, which until somebody told me it was English, I thought it was another tribal language. That's how Liberian it is. And then they have what they would say standard English, which is more to our understanding. And so we're able to do all our ministry in English. All our printed materials are in English. But obviously we get outside of the city and more into the bush area, and we use an interpreter there. And in that case, Liberia has 16 different tribes and 16 different tribal languages. And what's interesting about that is Liberia is only 5.5 million people, about the size of Kentucky. And yet it's not like Hispanics, where there's different dialects of Hispanic, and yet they kind of understand each other somewhat. They can cross over. It's not like that. This small country, 5.5 million people, 16 different tribal languages, and they don't understand one another. That's how distinctive they are in that. And so at that particular conferences, there was two different dialects, so we had the two interpreters. But we do all of our teaching in English. All our materials are in English. And so we listen. By the way, we didn't go to the mission field till we were, we started deputy, I was 57. We went when I was about 60. So don't think that God can't use you. Amen. And another thing, don't be afraid of where God may send you. He's not going to send you somewhere that you're not ready for. He wasn't going to send us someplace where we had to learn a language at 60 years old, I'll tell you that. So he knew where to put us. And he knows what to do with you if you're just willing to go and surrender. And trust me, you'll love it. I've always said if God wanted me, we live in Florida, by the way, when we're here in the States. If God wanted me to go to Canada or something, I'm willing to go. We just have a lot of deep conversations about that before I was convinced it was his will, as I love warm weather. And so trust me, wherever God wants you to serve, whether it's here, somewhere else, he's going to give you the heart for it. And it's going to be an easy process to follow his will. So anything else that I need to bring up before we just open it up? Can you think of anything? Okay. Any questions you might have? Yes.
How many other people are down there trying to do what you do, like Jehovah's Witnesses and other religious denominations?
Okay, that's a very good question. He asked about the other religions there. Muslims are very prominent there. They don't really push their Islam, but most of the shops, especially on the streets, the stores, like even we would go to, are owned by Lebanese, and they are Muslims. And it's kind of like what we heard this morning. We have good relationships with them. The man across the street from us, he was a Muslim. We'd buy our bread from him and get our water from him. We don't have running water in our home. And so you build good relationships with them. Is this being live stream? Okay. So yes. So they're prominent there. Charismatics are probably the largest influence because you saw our church. Well, that is way back off the road, isn't it, Jay? Jay's been there. Most of our Baptist churches are like that. They're off back in the road. You can't really tell somebody how to get there. A Liberian can, but I can't. The Pentecostals, they have money. They're out on the main streets. They got the big buildings. They got the loud music, which is very appealing to a Liberian culture. So they draw a lot in. Mormons are very active. They've got their nice church buildings as well, and they're there. I've had opportunity to talk with them. Brenda's brother and his family are very devout Mormons, and all their children have taken their 2 year mission trips. So with that, it opens up an opportunity for me to talk with some of the Mormons there. Jehovah's Witnesses are there. You know, they got a new emblem now. It's just the JW thing, and they have their churches. So it's kind of like I said this morning, we have complete religious freedom there, but everybody has that. And so everybody's there. One thing I will say, it's very interesting. It wasn't me who asked this question, but I had a guest there. I can't remember who it was. And he asked one of the pastors, he said, so do the Muslims, are they active like we are? He used the word recruit, trying to recruit people. And the pastor said, no, they get them from the time they're born in their schools. And there are lots of schools. And I know as Baptist, and we're seeing a change in this, and I'm so thankful for this, but it used to be church planting, church planting, church planting. If you're a missionary and you're not going to plant churches, we're not going to support you. Praise the Lord that the past several years they've recognized the need for education. For instance, I'm not going there at 60 years old to start a church and pastor that church. I knew that. So that's why we developed our Bible Institute, so that we can plant churches, yes, but then I'm training the nationals to pastor that church because he's going to stay there. I'm going to die off here probably sometime soon. So who's going to reach Liberians better than Liberians anyway? And so we're training them. And as you saw in the video, Pastor Sewall of Faith Baptist Church has gone through our college, and he's pastoring Faith Baptist Church. Voy, who you saw there in front of our property that we just purchased, has gone through our Bible college, still in it. He became the assistant pastor under Pastor Sewall, and now he's going back to his home village, Saclapie, and starting a church there. Also, what's interesting, you could see that, you know, our first property flooded that during the rainy season it started. What happened was when we purchased that back in, I think, 2013, it was the only building there. There was nothing else there. It was just standalone. And I actually was on the phone, cell phone, talking to a lady in Texas who owned that, and we purchased it. But what happened over the years was other people started building around us, and they built up, and our property became the reservoir for everybody else's property. And we prayed and looked for 2 years for a new property. And sometimes it was very discouraging that we couldn't find that. But God had a plan. And the property that you saw there is in walking distance from our old church building. We're able to still use that. You can see there was two small houses on that property, and it's a full acre. And then, of course, we built the wall and all that. We bought that property for $40,000, 1 acre. We just purchased, as you saw, the property in Saclapie, which, by the way, that's the first time Brenda saw it. I just got back a week and a half ago from Liberia, so she hadn't even seen the video of that. We purchased that 3 acres for $10,000. And that's the difference between being in the city and being in the bush. And so we should be able to build a building there, I'm thinking, for probably $20,000, $25,000. And so we're excited about that. Brother Voy is having Bible studies right now with 35 to 40 people. We had a tremendous service there just a week ago, Sunday, I think it was. I was there. Can't remember. Okay, another question. You can see I like to talk about our ministry. Anybody? Okay. Brenda has something. Okay, I'll let her. Brenda wants to explain the children's ministry going forward.
I guess I just wanted him to mention that even though we're not there on the ground right now, the children's ministry is going forward. I have one of the ladies that was there when they were singing the song, lady second to the on the right there. She just has a major heart for the Liberian children, and she has a great vision. She's a visionary, really, and she is going forward. I left her when we left our home in Liberia, the place that we were renting. I gave her all of my materials, everything that I had. And so she's holding workshops on her own, and she managed a children's retreat this past November, and there were about 200 children there. We're wanting other churches to be involved, and so she has workshops, and she invites them to come, and she'll hold a workshop and on teaching them how to lead children to the Lord, teaching, providing songs for them, providing materials and things that they need for their children's church. And so and my heart is just blessed with how it's going forward. God's good.
It's exciting to see the fruit of your labor. Our students training, becoming the pastors. Again, that was my purpose in going there. I will share this, and I know I'm probably taking too much time, preacher. One of the hopes I had when we started the Bible Institute was eventually to put those on video so we can go beyond just the classroom where we are meeting. But, you know, you just get busy in what you're doing the day to day, and to take on something else becomes very difficult. Well, COVID helped with that, just like it did here in the States. And so I actually started recording my classes and sending them to another missionary who works with me over there, a younger missionary who knows all the technical stuff that I don't. And so I was able to continue my teaching by video to our students. And now I'm actually even doing live stream. For instance, we'll get back to Florida Friday night, and I'll get up at 6:30 Saturday morning and teach a live class. And we're recording those. And so I've provided a video projector and computer and screen for Faith Baptist Church so that they can show the church people there. And we're able to do that in other areas as we progress. Brother Ben, who's the missionary working with me, he's actually holding classes in his church so that the students, we have students that come 2 hours away. And so that makes their travel time a lot easier as well. So, you know, there's times you kind of get a little discouraged because of the COVID. And then my wife had some cancer issues that kept us here. And you wonder what's going to happen. And God, he just expands your ministry. He reminds you that it's about him and it's not about us. And so we're just blessed to have the opportunity to serve there. It's frustrating. It's hard at times, but boy, it's a joy. It is such a blessing. Brother Jay's been there a couple of times. One thing about Liberia is, and I tell whenever we have guests and pastors come, first thing I say is, we don't have any wildlife, Justin. we have goats and chickens. That's what we have. So I want them to know that up front, because, listen, I thought I was going to get to see elephants and giraffes and goats and chickens. That's it. And we don't have any sightseeing places. It's pretty much all ministry, isn't it, Jay, when you come, you know, but the fellowship with the people and everything is just wonderful. And if you want to come, Brother Jay will be glad to lead a team over there. He loves coming to Liberia.
Thank you. All right. So if you had any questions, I'm sure Pastor would love to receive those. And so I know I found out there was a couple questions we missed, so I apologize for that. So I got to meet Rick just last fall. I was up at Maple City Baptist, and he's a good friend of Jay Goffman's, I think they live just nearby. His family, they're from Illinois, and his wife, you know, had his family there or what have you. So they just came through, and I got to meet him, and man, I could just tell it was a match. And I found out after the fact that he's also, for those of you who've been around long enough here at HBF, he's also is affiliated with Sam Strickland, and who, if many of you remember Sam Strickland, so I think, wow, what a small world it is. So they've traveled together and ministered together, and I thought, well, that just makes sense, right? So it's just a small world. So God is so good. So look forward to seeing them and continue to pray for them, and you'll be hearing more from them in days ahead. Okay, so tonight, we've got a few more things on deck, but before we move forward with the message, and you're going to hear from Alex Chippy here in just a little bit, I want to just take a moment once again and remind all of us that our kids are being not just watched, they're not just being entertained, they're being invested in. And I think you guys have had, I think Maple City Baptist had over 20 people come down to invest in this conference. And I know we've been doing it for years, but it's one of those things that you cannot take for granted. And I don't know what it is, but this year, yeah, come on up, Mike. I just wanted to invite Mike up because I'm thankful that Maple City is invested in Heartland, like they're making us a mission. But what I want to do is encourage us to make Maple City a mission. So I asked Mike to come up and just share a little bit about the blessing that it is when we come and invest in their church.
Hey, man, it is a big blessing to come up. And our church was, you know, we've been low on numbers here for a bit. But Sunday morning, we were so low, but it felt so good because we knew we were low because 20 of our best people were here. And as a church, that's how I want to be, you know. If we're lacking like that, it's because we're out doing the work. So, and a lot of you have been to Monmouth, and it's a huge blessing. Let me tell you a quick story. There's a lady over here with long blonde hair named Laura, staying with Sherry. This lady, you were talking about knocking on doors. Well, we're not door knockers, you know. We don't like to frighten children, but we decided let's do it. So we did it. And we started saying, hey, Sunday morning for the next 2 weeks, let's just make a ton of pancakes and sausage and invite everybody to come on the street. So we blocked off the streets, knocked on doors, telling them about Christ, the church, come on, eat some pancakes. You never have great results with that type of thing. There was one lady with long blonde hair that walked in and said, man, I'm a neighbor. I wasn't even home, but there was a door flyer. And she said, I just came to check you out and eat some pancakes. And that was, what, 6 months ago? Laura ended up meeting Jesus Christ, and we baptized her. And she said, I want to come on this missions trip. And you know, our church is on the south side. So Jeff told me, he goes, Mike, some of these kids, these homeschool kids are wild over here. He said, and I'm having a hard time getting them straight. And he goes, but Laura, yeah, she don't mess around. You know how south side moms are. She's like my mom. He's the man. She's getting them right in shape, you know. But you know what she told me? She said, I'm scared to go because I've never stayed in anybody's house that I didn't know. And man, Sherry called her. And Sherry said, hey, you'll be staying in my house. And Laura has some health issues. And Sherry's like, well, I'm a nurse. You'll be all right. And she came up and told me, and she said, I feel so much better going up. Guys, it is about the relationships. That's why we come. That's why I come, and I get to be with my friends. I've known Brian for years, so I just want to let you know that when you take these mission trips, like even if it's just a trip like a vacation Bible school right here in the state, it's about relationships. People want to come and stay with the same families, and I had, you know, Jay was up, Tony, these guys come to our conference in November, and all of a sudden Jay's like, hey, a friend of mine's coming up, a missionary. His name's Rick Osborne. I said, I don't know this guy. He comes up, like, this guy is from Joy, Illinois, like 40 minutes up the road. Like, I didn't know anything good can come from like the Midwest in Illinois. And I'm like, Rick, my gosh, man, we're family. And then I come up here and he's here. I didn't know he was going to be here. And I'm like, I know this man because we got a relationship now. And the Chippies are in the States, and I knew they were going to be here. Man, there are missionaries, man. We've been there twice down in Zambia with them, a team. And I'm telling you, it's about the relationships. It's so, so powerful. And so I just want to let you know that your carpet looks great. The walls look good because it was men from our church that painted these walls. See, it's all about relationships. But more importantly than that, I wanted to say that you look good. I mean, this stuff, you know, carpet and paint, I'm not lying. Every time I come up here, the relationships I have with you, I love coming up here because I know a lot of you and you know me, and we're doing the same thing, and we're, you know, same family. You know, and just to let you know, here's how much it's about relationships. Tonight on this exact day, 5 years ago, the conference was going on and I got a phone call saying, man, your daughter got admitted to the hospital and I had to make the trip back, and Josie got diagnosed with leukemia, and you carried us through. You know, it was all about, even today I'd see people, hey, man, I haven't seen you in a while. And they're like, hey, man, how's Josephine? And Josephine right now is in Bible school, taking some nursing. And she just called me on the way up yesterday and says, hey, Dad, I don't want to shock the pants off of you, but I don't know if nursing's it for me. She says, Dad, I'm considering doing ministry for like full time. And I said, well, you know what it's like to be poor. So I don't know where that's headed, but hey, guys, I just want to let you know that it's relationships, and you guys have been so gracious to me, to my family, and loved us, and man, it's just been, it's been a beautiful, beautiful, you know, journey. So anyways, thank you. It's a big blessing. And I guess there's probably nobody that's carried us more through as a family than Bo Green. But he works with me. This is, we're partners in crime together. We're both pastors in our church, and I mean it. His family, I'm telling you this, like everything and every story we have to tell, their names are in it because we do this thing together. So anyways, I just wanted to pass some love on to him. Thanks for letting our team come up. And now if you want a big blessing, you should come up to our place in November. I had to tell the Chippy girls today, I said, guys, you've not been to the best church in this whole land. It's down in Monmouth, you know. I don't know if they believe me or not, but anyways, hey, I love Bo Green. He's a pastor with me. I want him to come up and introduce Alex for us. So.
I'm the serious one. You never know what you're going to get with Pastor Mike, but no, he couldn't have said it better. Your church is kin to us, and what we have is just beautiful. Every spring and every fall, our vision conference, your vision conference. So children are no joke, and we know that what's happening over there, what happens with our children, it's a threat to the forces of darkness. So we would love for you guys to come. But having said that, we've had the privilege, our church has had the privilege of heading to Zambia several times, and Zambia, Africa. And the last time we were there, there was a dear man of God who we encountered. And when I say he's a man of integrity, a man of true, genuine character, I mean this. And I'm telling you this so that you guys would just give him your undivided attention, because this man of God is a blessing. And there's many pastors in the bushes of Zambia, Africa, that are feeding their flocks because of this man. This man is a church planter. He's a pastor. He's a Bible teacher. He was a professional soccer player, headed for success, what the world would say, that's where success is at, a professional soccer player in Zambia, Africa. And when the Lord was calling him to full-time ministry, he fought God for several years, as anybody in their right mind would. And when I heard his story about how he surrendered and just said, Lord, I'm done fighting you, and God had to put him through some infirmity to go through that resolve. But he's got my respect. And so this man of God is, he's a warrior. There's a lot of spiritual warfare that he goes through. And so many don't even know about this. And he's not going to tell you about it, because like I said earlier, he's a man of integrity. He's humble. And so I'm not talking this man up for no reason. When he was at our conference in 2020, he shared with us a verse in Acts 20, 24. And this is when Paul is speaking to the elders in Ephesus. He says, the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me, but none of these things move me. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy. And I remember when he shared that, I knew it, that he's speaking out of his life. I mean, this man, he lives what he preaches. And I'm so thankful for Alex Chippy. I'm thankful that he's a man who rebels against even culture when it's unbiblical. And a good example of that would be just watching him with his children. It's so different to see a man in his culture to love on his little girls the way that he does, and to have the relationships and to take a stand for what righteousness in spite of what other people think. And so I'm saying too much. I want you to come on up, Alex. I just wanted to give you guys a little glimpse of this guy's a man of God, and he deserves our attention. So take a few moments and share what God's doing in Zambia.
I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I just want to thank God for this wonderful opportunity he has given to me and my family. Being here is a huge blessing. I just want to say thank you to Pastor Hedges and the entire leadership of this church. We are so thankful for the invitation. Also, I just want to say thank you to Pastor Bo Green and Pastor Mike. You have been such a huge blessing to our family and the ministry. So may the Lord God Almighty continue to bless you. I just want to share some few things, our ministry back in Zambia. As he has shared, myself, I'm coming from Zambia. My wife, she is coming from here. She's an American. She is there. Our children, they are that side. You can stand so that they can see my beautiful wife. But you can see how beautiful she is. And I'm proud to be her husband. So without wasting much of our time, I would love just to pray before I could share so that God himself can take the full preeminence. Shall we just pray? Gracious, merciful Father, come we before thy throne with the precious blood of Jesus, the blood which was shed on the cross of Calvary for us. Thank you for this wonderful opportunity. In the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God, be with us, our Master. Without you, we can do nothing, and we are nothing without you. In the name of Jesus, the Son of the living God, we pray. Amen. Yeah, so I and my wife, we are coming from a very big ministry in Zambia. Pastor Edges and Pastor Rand Foster came, I think, is it 3 or 4 years ago? They came and actually Rand Foster and the wife, they served under this ministry for some years in Zambia. And they invested so much back there in Zambia. Even today, we still hear about them and what God did through this family. And I'm glad to be here. So right now, we are no longer with this ministry. The name of this ministry is the GCMS, God's Christian Missionary Services, and was founded by Americans. Bobby Bonner, even Rand, he was part of this ministry, and I think the other one is Rand Anderson. I think it's Anderson. That is the name of the missionaries I know, and a lot of missionaries have been through this mission station. So we have about 100 plus churches in the villages, and we have pastors, although I'm no longer with that ministry because that ministry has been handed over now to the nationals to take over, to be in charge. So Americans are no longer in charge. They are just supporting. They are just behind this ministry. So I and my wife, we were just part of the transition from Americans to the nationals. So after God told us that we are done, and he had to lead us out of the mission station, and he took us into the capital city of Zambia, Lusaka. And our vision is a little bit different with where we served from, because the focus was more into the village area. But this time it is in the capital city of Lusaka. That's where God is leading us. And we know that is not a small task. It is the big task where the city is concerned, because Lusaka is filled with these charismatic guys, and they have a lot of people following them. So it's not an easy thing, and we have a lot of churches, a lot of false teachers, preachers in the city. So we know that it's not going to be an easy thing, but we know and trust God that God is going to work through us. We just have to surrender to him. So we are church planters, as Pastor Bo Green shared. We are church planters. So we are planting a church in the capital city of Zambia. And we have small group there because this is when we are starting. And every Sunday, actually, I do Bible study with them through WhatsApp, because it's just a small group. So our vision, we just want this church to be a little bit different, because most of the churches, most especially if they know that there is a connection back here in the U.S., they have a tendency of depending from this side, which we know that that's not how it's supposed to be. Yes, support may come from this side, here and there, but the church itself has to be self-sustainable. So that is our vision. And in Lusaka, we have upper and the middle, lower classes. So our goal is to reach out to all. We are not going to leave any behind. We know reaching out to the rich people, those who are up there, is not an easy thing. It is easy for people without bread to come near Jesus. But it's difficult for people with bread to come near Jesus. And at the same time, we know that people without bread also coming near Jesus, at the same time, it's difficult for them to see the truth. As we can see in God's word, they followed Jesus because of the bread he multiplied. And also the rich, it is difficult to come to Jesus because they feel that they have everything. And we know that they need the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we are just praying for wisdom, how to reach out and how to blend together the upper class, middle, and the lower class. Because it's not an easy thing, because I have seen a lot of people with money, sometimes they don't want to mingle with the poor. But Jesus Christ himself, who was God 100% in the flesh, and he was God, both man and God. I can just say he was just God, but he humbled himself. He did not choose. He did not say this one has money or this one is up there. He was not like that. So even us, we have to follow his example. So our goals, we are doing evangelism, and the evangelism through going into the malls, like at the mall there, you can meet a lot of people at the mall, and also in the markets, and going door to door. That is our vision, and that's what we are doing where evangelism is concerned. The other angle we just want to use is using the sports festivals, where you invite families together with their children. You have like a festival. We just want to be doing things like that. And also, God is leading me to start preaching using the radio station once in a while to go and preach, because preaching using radio station, we are going to reach out to so many people in the capital city of Zambia. So we are just praying for God himself to help us as we are trying to plant this church. And when we go back, we just want to start renting a place, because right now we are meeting from our house because the number is still small. And when we go back, we are planning to look for a place where we can meet together. Because a lot of people, if you invite them coming to your house and they say, church at your house, because a lot of people, they know church is about the building, and we know that church is not about the building, but we just have to be strategic if we want to win people to come to Jesus Christ. We know that is very important. Even Paul himself, his vision actually was targeting the cities, the major cities. That was Paul's strategy, which we know that even us, we have to be strategic when it comes to reach out. So we are just asking for your prayers so that God himself can help us. It's not an easy task. I know even those who have been called into the village areas, it's difficult ministry. I can just say it is difficult. It's not an easy thing. It doesn't matter where you are. Ministry is a difficulty thing. This is the reason why we cannot do it in our own flesh. And I just want to share this quickly as I am wrapping up. I don't want to waste much of your time. It is something God laid on my heart as we move forward as the ministry, even as the family. He has been showing me some things in his word.
I know we are talking about advancing God's kingdom, where the Great Commission is concerned, where advancing His kingdom is concerned, by reaching out, planting new churches, which is very good, which is very good. And I like how you are this side in the U.S. You are mission-minded churches. This is the reason why even the church we are planting, it is going to be a mission-active church. We just want also to be participating. So God was showing me some things which convicted my heart. He was telling me that, Alex, how you have received this, where Great Commission is concerned, to determine how far you will go. It's about how we have received. It's about how we have responded, or determine how far we will go. And also, he was just reminding me concerning some people in the Bible, because others, because of this same Great Commission we have today, others, they went as far as losing all they had because of this. And others, they went as far as losing their lives because of this. Yeah, they went as far as losing their lives. I just want to read a verse. It's a reminder to each one of us, if we feel that we are involved, this has to sink in our minds, that others, they went as far as losing their lives because of reaching out, because of trying to do what God has called them to do. It's very, very important as children of God. So how we respond, it matters. How we respond, how we are going to respond at the end of this conference, will determine how far you will go as an individual and as a church. We have seen that in God's word. So I don't know if we are ready, because there are so many excuses. Because I have seen a lot of Christians, they just want God to come down to their conditions and terms. Oh, God, myself, I need this and that and that. And God doesn't work like that. We just have to abide to His terms and conditions, which we know that is not the matter of sugar and butter. There are some hard stuffs we are going to encounter as children of God, most especially if we just want to stand on the truth of God's word. It's not an easy thing, because even the so-called Christians will rise against us because of standing on the truth, which as the church of Jesus Christ, as an individual, we just have to stand on the truth of God's word. It's very, very important. And also, he was showing me that I have to let Ishmael go. I have to let Ishmael go. Ishmael is the picture of what the flesh can produce, of what the flesh can do. But Isaac, it is the picture of what God can do through us. If we die to this flesh, because Abraham and Sarah, they died for Isaac to be born. So there are some things in our lives, if we are not going to die to this flesh, to the world, something will never come out in our lives. So we have to die. He was telling me that Ishmael has to go. I don't know Ishmael in your life. I know my life very well, but Ishmael has to go. Isaac is God's will. Isaac is what God can do through us. So let me read quickly, and I will be done. I'm not preaching, but I'm just encouraging the body of Jesus Christ. So Philippians chapter 3, verses. I'll just begin reading from verses 4. This is Paul. Paul is saying, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and a Hebrew of Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, those I count loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, who for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. This is Paul. He's saying he lost all for the sake of Jesus Christ. So God is just reminding each one of us that this journey we are in is not an easy thing. You may lose even the job. You may lose your income in order to follow Jesus Christ. It's not an easy thing. But as children of God, we have to be ready to follow him and do what is right in the name of Jesus Christ. So I am so thankful once again. May the Lord God Almighty continue to bless this church and continue to pray for us. We are asking for your prayers, because without prayer, it's impossible for us to accomplish whatever God has laid on our hearts. God bless you.
This is called an audible. I just wanted to take a moment and pray over Alex, because he doesn't have a lot of time with us in this conference, and he's still here with us. Pastor Randy, you feel up to coming up here, maybe leading in a prayer? I just want to take some time. This man is endeavoring in a new work, and I really appreciate his spirit and what he's doing. And I appreciate the connection that God is given us through not just the ministry of Maple City, but also Pastor Randy. And so I just like to take a moment. Let's all just pray over Alex and Crystal and their family, and just ask God to bless this new ministry chapter in their life.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for today, that we've had an opportunity to hear the heart of a man that wants to serve you to the fullest extent of his life. Father, I pray that you would just bless him and his family. You would provide the protection that they need and the things that they need to be able to continue in ministry as they travel around in a country that's not all theirs, but Lord, that they want to bring glory to you in the ways that they minister. I pray, Father, that you would go before them and prepare the ground for the church that is their desire to plant. I pray, Father, that the work of that church would go forth in a powerful way and be the reflection of who you are and what you desire for the country of Zambia. Lord, what a heart I know that this man has, and his wife and even his children. They love you. They desire to please you, and they desire to have you be manifest in so many other lives as possible. And I pray, Father, you give them the strength to accomplish that, that you allow them to be serving you in every capacity. I pray, Father, for their health. Lord, that you would keep them healthy, that you would strengthen their bodies, that you would protect them spiritually, you would protect them physically, and you protect them emotionally, Father. attacks come so many different directions in a country like Zambia. Lord, I pray that you just be the hedge about their life, about the church, so that they may be able to serve you, and that the people of Zambia, and especially in Lusaka, would look at this church and say, there is God. God is present in this man's life, and in his family's life, and in this church's life. And I pray, Father, for their strength. We love you. We love what you're doing. We want to serve you to the best of our ability. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen.
Rachel Saint was an evangelical Christian missionary from the United States who worked in Ecuador. Rachel was born in Wincott, Pennsylvania. She attended the Philadelphia School of the Bible and then worked at the Keswick Colony of Mercy in New Jersey. Rachel Saint was sent out by the Wycliffe Bible Translators, trained by Summer Institute of Linguistics. Her first missionary assignment was to the Piro and Chapara in Peru, but she had an interest in the Wahari in Ecuador.
When I was 18 years old, my good friend, Mrs. Parmalee, took me on a voyage to Great Britain. She was very fond of me, thought of me as her own daughter. Towards the end of our voyage, she asked me to come and be her lifelong companion. In return, she would make me an heiress to her fortune. I was a bit taken aback by that and would give her an answer at the end of the voyage. It was a decision I contemplated, as my parents would have been overjoyed with my good fortune. I knew in my heart that God had a different plan for me. At sunrise, I walked out onto the deck of that ship and looked over the horizon and saw the coastline of North America. Suddenly, I was no longer on the ship, but in a desert clearing, staring at a group of brown-skinned, half-naked people. As quickly as the vision came, it went. I wondered if I had just had a vision from God. Without thinking, I fell to my knees and prayed, God, I give my whole life to you. If you want me to go and be a missionary to these brown-skinned people, I will do so. That was the beginning of my journey in the mission field and those brown-skinned people.
In February 1955, Rachel went to a missionary station near Wahari territory, where Rachel Saint's brother was working. Rachel Saint started learning the Wahari language, and with the help of Deyuwama, a Wahari woman who had left her people after dispute and was sheltered by missionaries. In January 1956, five missionaries in the area were killed by the Wahari people, the Akuas, as their enemies called them, including her brother, Nate Saint, who had come to Ecuador in 1948. Rachel was more than ever determined to reach the Huaroni. In 1957, she embarked on a tour of the United States together with Dial Room, appearing with Billy Graham at Madison Square Garden and on Ralph Edwards' television show, This Is Your Life. In the summer of 1958, Rachel Saint returned to the Huaroni in Ecuador, and together with Elizabeth Elliott, the wife of James Elliott, who had been killed by the Huaroni, continued to evangelize. In February 1959, they were able to move into the Huaroni settlement. Rachel continued in her labor to create a dictionary of the Huaroni language. Rachel lived many years with the tribe, and in 1977, Rachel left the jungle with a heavy heart. In 1992, Rachel returned to present them with a New Testament in their language. Rachel died November 11th, 1994, and is buried near her brother, Nate, in the Huaroni territory.
Amen. I think Mary did a great job. What a theme that we have, right? When we talk about the mission of God and accomplishing God's mission and God's power for God's glory, right, by His grace, it costs us, right, a living sacrifice, and we're to be wholly acceptable unto God, which is reasonable. But what a challenge we've seen tonight. We've seen living epistles and examples of that, and what a blessing it is. And I'm excited for all that God's doing with the Osbournes, what God's doing with the Chippies, what God has done in the past, and what God's going to do in the future. And our next speaker and our primary preacher tonight is Thomas Harding. I've known Thomas for several years. I've met him up at New Philly when he and his wife were up there and starting their family, when I was going out to Certainty conferences and such. And then probably it was about six years ago, probably, you guys transitioned down to Cartersville, Georgia, Oakland Heights Baptist. And at the time was Joe McKaig was the pastor. And then, of course, now James DeCoker has transitioned into that role as Joe has gone back to Decatur to take that church. And man, Thomas, and they have served in that church faithfully, and now they're stepping out, right? They're taking that next step by faith and going to the soft city of Portland. And so he's fighting a real battle, getting ready to go and really try to see God do a work in another big city, similar to what Alex was talking about, the big city difficulties come. And I'm looking forward to all of those things that God's going to do. And we're going to get behind him in prayer and supporting him in that area. But I wanted Thomas to come tonight and just preach the word of God to us. Thomas, you come, give him some HBF love as he comes to preach to us.
All right, good evening. I'm going to take just a moment to settle in up here, if that's all right with you. And while I do, would you guys grab your Bibles? We're going to waste no time this evening getting into God's Word. And I've got something for you to do just so we can get started in our time. I can know that you're alert and with me. You guys know what a sword drill is? If you have a physical Bible, you grab it by the binding and hold it in the air. Let me see them. The first person that gets to the reference stands up and reads it, and you win bragging rights today. Your verse is Jeremiah 17:10. Perfect. Thank you. Give her a round of applause. All right. And now for our time and our text, you can turn your Bibles to Amos chapter 7. You can keep your finger there. We'll come back to that reference in a moment, but we're going to get started. By the way, we are planning a church in Portland, Oregon, and we'll tell you about that if you come to tomorrow's session in the morning. We're going to lay all that out in a more casual way. Tonight, we're going to spend a little bit of time in God's Word. So Amos chapter 7 is where we're going to be this evening. And once you land there, I'm going to take just a moment. I know we prayed a lot But I want to just give us a moment of silence to just ask God to just settle us in. I'll try to do as best I can with our time, get us out to dinner or whatever we're going to do tonight. So let's take a moment. Just pray for yourself right now that God would speak to you and humble us before his word. God, I do pray for each person here tonight. You know the hearts and the purpose that you created them for, what you're calling them to. God, I hear the kids down the hallway. I pray you'd bless them, even my kids tonight, God, that today would be the day of salvation for my son, Watson. God, that my son, Fitz, would hear your word. God, that my son, Bingham, would grow to walk with you. And God, for each heart in this building, to just be humbled and submitted to what you say. Help us. We need your grace. We need your mercy. Teach us tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Amos chapter 7. I want to set you up with the timeline of where we are. 760 BC. We're going back in time. The kingdom of Israel is divided. The northern and the southern kingdoms. We'll see this man, Jeroboam the second, is the king at the current time. We're going to settle into the northern kingdom of Israel. During this time, Israel is apostate. They are not making good decisions. If you would read the book of Hosea or 2 Kings chapter 14, you would see what's going on spiritually. There is a lot of golden calf worship. For whatever reason, Israel likes golden calves. They're doing that thing. And we have a couple of main characters today. Our text, we're going to see a dialogue between two people. Amos the prophet and this other guy named Amaziah. And Jeroboam is mentioned, but he doesn't get any time in the story. So Amos is a shepherd farmer. He's from Tekoa, if you look at chapter 1, verse 1. And God called him to preach. He was a contemporary of Hosea, and his message is pretty tough, man. He weighs heavy on judgment. He calls out false gods by name in chapter 3 and verse 8. And he says multiple times to seek the Lord, chapter 5, verse 6. He has a tough message. Amaziah is called the priest of Bethel. He oversees the religious worship of this apostate religion that Israel has set up. And he has the king's ear. We have an intertwined political and spiritual kind of situation during this time in Israel. And then we have the king, Jeroboam the second. He did not serve the Lord. He was not a good man, but he did do good things for Israel. It is kind of strange, and it reminds me of a recent leader in our country that did great things for our country, but did not humble themselves before the Lord. That's Jeroboam II. It's a sad ending. We'll see the end of his legacy at the end of our time together. If you've got a handout, we're going to knock out some of those points, and we're going to look at this dialogue back and forth, and we'll learn something from it. We'll start with point number one, which is the standard for preaching. The standard, starting in verse 7. Thus he showed me, and behold, the Lord stood upon a wall made by a plumb line with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said unto me, Amos, what seest thou? And I said, a plumb line. Then said the Lord, behold, I will set a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will not again pass by them anymore. In the high places of Isaac shall be desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste, and I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. In our text here, we begin with Jeremiah getting a vision. And if you would read prior to where we are, you'd see that he has seen grasshoppers come in verse 1 and destroy Israel. In verse 4, he sees fire come and destroy Israel, and each time he intercedes for Israel as a good prophet does. He says, God, we don't want your judgment, save us. And twice it says the Lord repented and removed judgment. God is looking for men and women like Amos, that we would stand and intercede, preach the truth. But we have to be careful about which truth we preach. Point A is God's standard. That's the standard for preaching. It is God's standard. As you see in verse 7, it says, the Lord stood upon a wall made by a plumb line. And a plumb line is, I got to figure out which slides. Okay, that slide's that one. All right. There's a picture of a plumb line. If you don't know what that is, it's really simple. It's how to make a wall straight. Gravity and something heavy and a string, and it lets you know if something is lined up in the right way. We know that we have the standard. We have God's word, and he has a plumb line. And there's a nail up here. Something might be falling apart. I don't know what that's from. Sorry. We have God's word. He has the standard. We have the truth. But we have to be careful about what in which we are preaching. Deuteronomy 32:4 says that the Lord, he is the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment. A God of truth. Without iniquity, just and right is he. It's God's standard that we have to preach. Secondly, we see God's judgment. Point B, God's judgment. Verse 8, God speaking in the first person, I will set a plumb line in the midst of my people. This is an Amos's desire. It's what God is saying that he is going to do. But what is Amos preaching? His tradition? His politics? Or is it God's word? You know what a crooked wall looks like when you set a plumb line up against it? Maybe you've seen something like this in your basement before. If you go to buy a house and you see this on the foundation, I lived in a house that had a garage that looked like this one time. You know, this is a big problem, right? And when God judges, when his spirit and his truth peer into the heart of man or into a nation, he sees very clearly that we are all just a bode wall. And the verse that I gave you for your sword drill is Jeremiah 17:10. I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. You see, God is ultimately the one that gets to judge. And we're going to talk in a moment about bringing the heat and evangelism. You're going to have to tell people they're sinners and there is a destination for them if they don't accept the Lord. And you're going to have to be real careful that you're not injecting your own judgment. You guys know where I'm going. You could probably imagine the conservative perspective on a liberal place in our country and all of the things that would be very easy to get upset about, right? We have to be careful. I've done this. I call it taking the bait. You get into an evangelism conversation with somebody, the next thing you know, you're having a totally different conversation about politics, about LGBTQ plus rights, or about how to raise kids or the role of a woman in the family, and you're not talking about Jesus anymore. You bit into something that's now got you totally off from getting to the cross, the important part of accepting the Lord. And, you know, it's sometimes in our own flesh, our own zeal, we feel a certain kind of way about something, and we miss the gospel for that. So I put it to you this way in your notes. If your preaching is to satisfy your own judgment, your motives are wrong. When you go to tell somebody, hey, man, Jesus paid for your sin, do you really maybe secretly just want them to pay for their sin? Are you disgusted by the way that people choose to live their lives? You'll never reach somebody that you hate. Matthew Henry says, it was the business of prophets to pray for those to whom they prophesied, and so to show they did not desire the woeful day. Effective evangelism and church planting, going to reach a people, has to begin with your heart. And you have to be able to stand between them and God and say, God, forgive them. Is that not the heart of Christ? But we might need a sort of a conversion, not your salvation, but a change of heart. And I have to admit, I'll share more tomorrow morning about Portland. My first survey trip when we went there, I was not excited. I didn't choose Portland. I was voluntold. I was going to scout it out. And from the airport to my Airbnb, I was just like, I don't want to. I got a new pair of shoes because I did not want Portland on my shoes. Honestly, I was not very happy about it. And the very next morning I woke up, I did an LFBI assignment for journaling through the Gospels. In Luke chapter 13, Jesus says, Jesus answering, saying unto them, "Suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all Galileans because they suffered such things. I tell you, nay, but except you repent, ye shall all likewise perish." You think someone else is so bad, so wicked, that they are going to get what they've got coming. And Jesus says, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. And reading that really gave me a fresh perspective then to be able to see Portland to say, okay, sin is sin. It doesn't matter what it is. Everywhere needs the gospel. This place doesn't have a good church. Maybe that's something that we could do. We have to be careful about our preaching, that it's not just our preferences, our opinions, our own zeal. And thirdly, we see God's consequences in our standard for preaching. Verse 8, a harrowing verse. God says, "I will not again pass by them anymore." It's perhaps the worst thing that could be said about anyone. God's saying, "I won't give you another chance." That should shock you to your core. And the sad reality is there's people in our lives that we don't know which day they're going to draw their last breath. And God is merciful. He's long-suffering, but we have a life that we don't know how many days we're going to get. Isaiah 59, "Your iniquities have separated between you and your God." That's man's problem. We're the bowed wall. But do you really believe that? When you look at your friends and your family, your own children, if they don't know the Lord, do you believe that there will come a day when they will never be able to choose to repent again if they don't do it in this lifetime? I put it to you this way in your notes. If you fully understand the gospel and the consequences of it, then you have a duty to preach to your neighbors. Do you understand the consequence of the gospel? To not accepting the gospel is eternity in hell. But what is your message? When you walk out the door, is that what you're concerned with the souls around you? You just content to watch your neighbors make poor decisions with their life, end up without the Lord? See, God's called you to preach just like Amos. When you step out your doors, you need to at least be open to God. Who is it? Who do I talk to today? But that message, remember Amos' message, is it's heavy on judgment. It's not a very easy one to hear. Hey, you need to repent. Jesus says, repent and believe the gospel. That's not a very exciting one. I've been told in Portland that won't fly. Well, I'm sure it won't. But Amos is going to have a response. So that's point number two, the response to preaching. What's going to happen when you share the gospel? Maybe people will get saved, praise the Lord, and I'm sure there are easier fields than others. But let's look at what is said to Amos, verse 10. "Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to Jeroboam, king of Israel, saying, Amos hath conspired against thee in the midst of the house of Israel, and the land is not able to bear all his words." Tattletale. He heads to the king. Hey, man, this guy is talking smack against you, right? Verse 11, "For thus saith Amos, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel shall surely be led away captive out of their own land. Also Amaziah said unto Amos, O thou seer, go, flee thee away into the land of Judah, and there eat bread, and prophesy there. But prophesy not again any more at Bethel, for it is the king's chapel, and it is the king's court." Have you ever had anybody tell you, just stop preaching? I don't want to hear it. Well, let's look at how to handle opposition when it comes. Point A is that you can just expect opposition. It's going to happen. There are people that, man, God is drawing all men to himself, and we don't know at what point people are in the process of coming to know the Lord. There are people that will get saved, but there are a lot of people that will reject you. And you have to remember that we are in a spiritual battle. Ephesians 6, "We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers." You know the verse, right? on a Monday night. You guys are the ones. You know what I'm talking about. It's not unlike what happened to other men of God. Moses, according to 2 Timothy, the Bible says that he had sorcerers resist the truth. The Apostle Paul, in his first missionary journey in Acts 13, he's immediately met with a sorcerer named Elymas. He's trying to bewitch the people. These people are out there. And if you're going to share the gospel, you're going to end up on their radar. You're going to find people that are actually into witchcraft. People that are actually listening to other spirits of divination. People that are working for the enemy to resist the truth. And if you've paid attention to the news in this country, you know that truth is not something we're really interested in anymore. We have decided we don't want that. We want something else. And we now have people that will advocate for a lack of truth. I put it to you this way in your notes. When you preach the gospel, you will get the attention of the enemy. I don't mean to freak you out. You put on your armor, read the rest of Ephesians 6. You'll be fine. You'll see some spooky, weird stuff depending on where you are. One of the things that draws me to Portland is just a bizarre place. It does not feel like the United States of America. It's strange. When we're evangelizing, we'll be literally sharing Romans Road with somebody. We'll just have somebody walk up in between us and just start making weird things in between us and the person we're evangelizing. I mean, just strange stuff happens, and you just have to say, okay, what? If they're not hurting me, we're just going to keep rolling. But did you really think that you're going to get away with it? Did you really think that you're going to get to snatch sinners out of the hands of the adversary and see them translated into the kingdom of his dear son, and that's just going to be fine with the devil? I mean, Colossians 1, you know that we've been delivered from the power of darkness, translated. We've totally been changed, totally reformed on the inside from kingdom to kingdom. This is why you've got to be proven. You've got to be effective in the mission. You're going to take some shots. And oftentimes, those shots aren't where you are totally protected. We just did an Easter service in Portland, and while I was there, my wife and kids were at home struggling. And I was several thousand miles away, helpless, to be able to help them. There's a terrible feeling that the adversary doesn't fight fair. Your enemy isn't just going to take out the big guy, man. He's taking out the little vulnerable people. That's why we pray for our kids. I refuse to go on the mission if my kids don't get saved, if my marriage falls apart. I refuse. Point B is you can expect misrepresentation. Amaziah here calls Amos's message conspiracy in verse 10. He says his words are a burden to Israel. Maybe you've had people say, we don't want any of that. That's, man, you're bringing us down with all your judgment talk. That's not very American of you. But his preaching was sound. If his hearers would have believed it, if Jeroboam II would have believed it, Israel could have been saved from, they're about to be sacked, taken over. Well, let's just think about your message for a moment. Knowing that people are going to try to distort your message, maybe you've had this happen before. Maybe you've taken the bait in a conversation and you end up in the women's rights kind of conversation with somebody. And the person that you're disagreeing with walks away, not thinking about Jesus, just thinking about, man, that guy's just a jerk. He doesn't care about women or whatever. If we're not careful, our message is going to be usurped by everything else. Knowing that they're going to already twist it, you've got to be careful. So let me ask you, do you preach conservatism? Is Fox News what you preach? Is it politics? Is it religion? You got to be in church, man. Is it some kind of preference that you have for how you do worship or church or even Bible version? I'm a King James guy, by the way, but That's not really going to help you on the street to try to talk to lost people about which Bible they're reading. Let's just get them into a conversation around the scriptures. The Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 2, he says, "My speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom." You don't have to do a whole lot of persuading. You just preach the gospel. You lovingly try to get to Jesus as fast as you can. Try to deflect all the other things that are setting off all of your alarms in your mind for, that's crazy. Why would you do that? So I put it to you this way. I ask you a question in your notes. If a friend or coworker would summarize your message, would it be salvation? What's on your lips? What are you passionate about? What are you preaching? Let it be the gospel. Let it be the gospel. And point C is that you can expect rejection. If you're going to share the gospel with people, just know you're going to be rejected. When we go to Portland, we've been taking evangelism teams, and we're just getting into the most populated area we can and just trying to grab people in crowds, do Brian Clark's thing, and get to Jesus. And you'd be surprised how many people just don't even want to talk to you. I think I've been to England, and Portland is certainly more open in a sense of people have a moral duty to at least be nice to you for a moment and talk to you. But when you get to Jesus, people are like, oh no, not that. I'm good. We have people hand us our tracts back to us like, no, I don't want this. Thank you. I was cool until it was church, and then I'm not interested. You can just expect it. I'd say about 1 out of 10 people that we try to get something into their hands, maybe 1 out of 10 will take it. People just don't want it. And honestly, we're bothering people on the street. You know, I get it. You don't want to be bothered by people. It's fine. But you're going to have to just get over the fear of rejection. And if you want help with that, I'm hopeful to be there this summer so that next summer we can have teams come and we'll just get you on the street and we'll point you at as many lost people as you can handle. It'll be great. You'll in about a day or so, you'll just get over it. You'll be like, okay, well, no one likes me. I'm moving on. It'll be fine. And if you can do it there, you can do it here. But you can expect rejection. Look at verse 12. Also, Amaziah said unto Amos, O thou seer, go, flee thee away into the land of Judah, and there eat bread and prophesy there. But prophesy not again any more at Bethel, for it is the king's chapel and it is the king's court. Amos is simply told, go preach somewhere else. And for many of us, that's enough rejection for us to be upset. But that is about a light of rejection as you can get. And we prayed this morning for people in India. That I don't know if you followed any of the news lately with India's, they're in a tough spot. The whole country is opposed to Christianity, burning churches, beating people. And somebody doesn't like you and you're upset about it? Man, if you stand for judgment and truth and the gospel, there are going to be people like Amaziah. They have a horse in the race. They do care about politics. They do care about the course of this world. And you're trying to mess up their system with your Jesus. They are not going to go down lightly. They aren't going to want you around. I resonate with Bethel in this case. Bethel's not supposed to be the house of worship. Jerusalem is. But Bethel is the place where the king is, and so is this religion and this calf worship. It is definitely the place where things go down. And if you ask me, if you look to the northwest part of our country, I mean, they're advanced, progressive in a lot of ways that the rest of our country is going. In my hometown area, New Philadelphia, Ohio, the last time I was there, they have a magic store in town where you can buy rocks and crystals and potions and sage and all that. I mean, you can buy those things in Marshall's or TJ Maxx now. All of our country is going the way that that stuff is going. We rejected God, but we want spiritual things, and so we just get spooky weird. And I'm convinced Portland is just the place where all that's swirling around, and we're going to go try to get crazily get in the middle of it. See who wants to be saved. See what happens. But let's talk about point number three, the confidence in preaching. What are you going to do when you take a shot, when someone says, hey, you can't do that here? You can't bring your Bible to school. You can't talk about Jesus at work. Are you going to, oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't know I needed your permission. You don't. I mean, be wise as serpents and harmless as doves, but you can talk about Jesus at work. You'll be fine. If people respect your character, if they know your heart, that you care about them and you're doing it in a timely way, you'll be fine. I had a boss, a VP of engineering, who kindly brought me aside and said, hey, stop trying to save everybody. He respected me enough. He knew what I was about, but he did it in a polite way, and he knew that I was trying to do the right thing. You'll be fine. Let's look at verse 14. Then answered Amos and said to Amaziah, I was no prophet, neither was I a prophet's son, but I was an herdman and a gatherer of sycamore fruit. And the Lord took me as I followed the flock, and the Lord said unto me, go, prophesy unto my people Israel. When you're rejected in evangelism, you're going to have some difficult days. When your family takes shots, when personally you take shots, you're going to need to say, God, is this what you want from me? Am I doing the right thing? It feels like it's harder than it's supposed to be. You're going to need to go back to what did God tell you to do? So let's talk about your calling, point A. Amos says in verse 15, the Lord said unto me, I think it was Justin last night that was talking about needing to be in God's word for all of our big decisions. Everything that we do, we need God's word on what we do. You need to know that whatever ministry or career or decisions that you're making in your life, that God is directing you to put you in those places. You need to have Amos's kind of confidence. And can I just share with you now, as a Christian, let me give you the boldness in God's word. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, if any man be in Christ, that's you, believer, if you're saved, then verse 18, you are given the ministry of reconciliation. You are called by God to see lost man and holy God be reconciled together through his son, Jesus Christ. You are called to do that. Every single believer is capable of reproducing another believer. You may not make it your career. You may not become a pastor, but you have that ministry. So when someone says, you can't do that, you just say, man, you take that up with the Lord. I am sharing the gospel with people. And we all love Romans 10:13. Does anyone know 10:13 by heart? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, yeah, shall be saved. But what about verse 14? How shall they hear without a preacher? We need some preachers. And I'm not talking about guys up here in suits. Maybe you call your pastor a preacher. You know, I grew up in a country church where he's the preacher. You, as a Christian with the ministry of reconciliation, you are a preacher. And there are people that are not going to hear the gospel except that you take your feet to them, you use your mouth, and you share what God's word says. You can do that in whatever kind of modern context you want to, but we need people to share the gospel. People are not getting saved without somebody ministering the word to them. I'm brand new to the iPad thing. I just lost my place. I'm trying to figure that out. All right. So we saw your calling. Let's look at your experience. Your experience. Verse 14, Amos says, this is a famous verse. I was no prophet, neither was I a prophet's son, but I was an herdman and a gatherer of sycamore fruit. Maybe you can relate. Maybe you're a blue collar kind of person, you don't have any formal training. You're like, listen, man, I didn't sign up for this. I didn't go to the school of the prophets. I was just watching the flocks. I was gathering fruit, and the Lord just told me, hey, this is what you're going to do. And God likes to do that, by the way. Matthew Henry says, he was, speaking of Amos, he was a plain countryman, bred up and employed in country work and used to country fare. Maybe that's you. We had biscuits this morning. You know, I'm currently kind of living in Cartersville, Georgia, where greens are a thing, like turnip greens. I don't eat them, but they're there. I am into the rest of the country fair, chicken fried, whatever. I'm good with all that, man. Good with gravy and all the country stuff. But I can relate to Amos in this way. Maybe you can. He's not built for Bethel. Bethel's the king's court. That's what, hey, man, you don't belong here. But that's where God sends him. And if it were up to me in my flesh for what I want, I'm a little more country than maybe you realize. And don't let the mustache make you think that I'm that cool. I grew up pretty redneck in a really small town. If it were up to me, I have three boys. Man, we'd move to the backwoods of Cartersville. We would have property. We would blow things up, catch things on fire, ride dirt bikes, chop down trees. You know, we would do all the stuff the country people do. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That's what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. Yes. Y'all are my people. I'm staying with the Millers. Their property is wonderful, man. They have taken my kids out and ride around on a side-by-side, get a snapping turtle claw for them, and just doing all this stuff outside. I got boys. You got to go outside with boys, right? That's what I would prefer. Even in the suburbs of Cartersville, I had this massive amount of trees that I had thrown gasoline on and started a fire with, and like totally exploded everywhere. And all of my neighbors start coming out of their houses like, what's going on over there? I'm like living in a suburb, you know? I would prefer that. But when you think about ministry, when you think about souls, when you think about eternity and what am I gonna do with my life, you're just gonna hole up somewhere and enjoy your country bumpkin life, or are you gonna get out and preach the gospel? And what I saw in Portland was people walking every which way all the time, like, man, there's so much potential. Who do we talk to? If you want to be about the business of souls, you might need to let the Lord relocate you to where there's a higher density. I say that, though, but I am encouraged about your taking it to the streets thing. On the way in here, I was telling my wife, like, all these fields, like, how do they reach people? They're so spread out. And man, I came here and heard you guys. You got a plan. I'm so excited about that. I think that is amazing. Praise the Lord. I think you guys are doing awesome. But let me just take one of your excuses for evangelism away. Acts chapter 4. They took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. Peter and John, they were unlearned. They were ignorant men. And the people around them marveled. Man, these guys don't have any formal training. But we know they've been hanging out with this Jesus guy. If you will let that be your testimony, you will let that be your life, God will use you. So I put it to you this way. You don't need much experience to preach the gospel. You can start with your testimony. You can be blue collar, and you can get something done for the Lord. But I do want to talk just for a moment about training. I mean, in the prophets, things worked a little different. Suddenly, God starts speaking to a man. Okay, well, that's what we're going to do. We've heard about Jonah. You know, we don't want to go the opposite way. We got to follow what the Lord says. And for many of us, in our zeal, we might say, man, I'm ready to go. But we have the whole rest of the Bible. According to 1 Timothy chapter 5, we lay hands suddenly on no man. According to 1 Timothy chapter 3, the requirement for a bishop is not a novice. So although you may feel called, praise the Lord, my prayer for you today is that people would hear the call to go, whatever that means for you. You also have to be proven. You need some training. You need some experience. So let's look at Amos's experience. First, he was a shepherd. In verse 14, he says, I was an herdman. In verse 15, he says, the Lord took me as I followed the flock. And if you would go to chapter 1, verse 1, he says, I was among the herdmen of Tekoa. See, before you can ever preach to kings in the king's court, you have to first be faithful to the flock. The few sheep, those little sheep, the lambs. Maybe you do want the spotlight. Maybe you do want the ministry. Praise the Lord, pursue that. If you desire it, go for it. But you have to grow in your diligence in shepherding souls. And let us, honestly, let that start in the home. We have kids. Husbands, we have wives. We have a small responsibility at home. Maybe that starts in children's ministry in a place that's just not sexy. There's just a lot of ministry that's not sexy, right? But God proves us out. Can you be a shepherd? Can you care for souls? Remember, Amos was preaching judgment, but he wanted repentance. Luke 16, he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. So I put it to you this way. If you want the Lord to use you in a greater way, be faithful to the responsibilities and the souls that you currently have. So if you want to go, if you want to follow the example of men that are going and planting churches and starting a new work, then you need to be a shepherd. Secondly, you also need to be an evangelist. Verse 14, he says he's a gatherer of sycamore fruit. Amos had two jobs. Maybe some of you can relate to that. Seasonal jobs. Many would say that he was poor because of this reason. He didn't just have one career. But if you want public ministry, if you want more, if you want to go, you've got to be faithful in the field of evangelism. You have to be a gatherer of fruit. Because Jesus says in John 15, herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. First, you need to be a disciple. And if you're going to make a disciple, you're going to teach them to evangelize. And what I found in my personal experience in getting ready to plant a church is that evangelism starts with me. I don't have to be the best at it. Paul said you can do the work of an evangelist even if you're not gifted at it. But it's up to me. People are looking to me. What's the vision? What do we do? When we get on the street, how do we engage with people? So I have to be the example. I have to be faithful. But to me, that takes a lot of the pressure off. I don't have to do it all. I just need to equip the body. We need to get other people moving. Get the body parts pointed at lost people. So I put it to you this way. If you want the Lord to use you in a greater way, prove yourself as a fruitful laborer in the field of evangelism. I mean, honestly, would you hire a pastor that's never led anyone to Christ? Would you support a missionary that said, I've never discipled anybody, but I'm ready to, I'll figure it out when I get there. Now, right now is when you get your reps in. And you do that every day. However God leads you, I don't walk out on the street every day and talk to random people, but, well, my life currently is upside down. I sold my home. I'm living on the road right now. Things are different. But when I had a real life, a normal one, I had a schedule where I went to the gym, and I was frequently just trying to engage people at this consistent times in the week, still being out in the world, just trying to interact with people. Well, let's close up with point number four, which is the consequence of preaching. Maybe you're tempted to change your message when you're rejected. Man, this judgment thing, it's not going over so well. I got kicked out. Let's start with something a little softer like Jesus loves you. Let's look at Amos's response in verse 16. He says, now therefore, hear thou the word of the Lord. Thou sayest, prophesy not against Israel, and drop not thy word against the house of Isaac. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, thy wife shall be an harlot in the city, and thy sons and thy daughters shall fall by the sword, and thy land shall be divided by line, and thou shalt die in a polluted land, and Israel shall surely go into captivity forth of his land. Man, Amos turned the heat up even more. Hey, you reject the Lord? Let me tell you what's going to happen. And I think we need this reminder. Oftentimes, we're trying to be polite in evangelism. You don't want Jesus? Okay, that's fine. God bless you. And what we need to do is leave our audience in a place of vulnerability. Hey, man, if you don't accept Christ, I just want you to know, you're not saved. You're not right with God. You don't have to be a jerk about it. You let the Holy Spirit lead you You need to listen to his voice in conversations. When you're talking to other people, you need to be thinking more than about what's happening. You need to be praying. You need to be listening. But check this out. I mean, this is a harsh list. I think I put the list for you up on the screen so that you could see them all. This is the consequence of sin. Your family. What does a family without the Lord look like? Can they ever truly function according to design? No. Amaziah's wife is going to be a harlot. Y'all know what that is. Sons and daughters slain. You see, if we did it God's way, according to Malachi chapter 4, he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children. How about possessions? Thy land shall be divided. How about a person's own life? Hey, don't forget, you're going to die in a polluted land, Amaziah. Or how about the legacy of a lost person? Israel shall surely go into captivity. Can you imagine that that's what you're known for? I led this nation into the ground so it could be taken captive by other people. But we have to wonder, what legacy are we living for? Jeroboam II, he actually did some great things. He expanded Israel's coast. He just didn't repent. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? That's Jeroboam II. This was meaningful to me, and I'll talk more in the morning about accepting the call to Portland. But you have to wonder, if you get one shot at your life and you see an opportunity, what do you want to leave behind? What do you want your wife and your kids in 10, 20, 30, 50 years of your life that you're going to labor and do? What do you want to be left whenever you can't work anymore? You get too old, you're not sharp, you lose your, whatever, man. What do you want to be left behind? Luke chapter 15, Jesus says, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And that's how I felt about Portland. And these people are experiencing the consequences of not accepting the gospel. The church that I'm currently at, Oakland Heights, man, they are killing it. We're slugging it out. Things are online. We got a training ministry where we just ordained a pastor and in my place, you know, like things are happening. And I could stay here with the 99, or the heart of Christ is to go. And we may not find 99 there. There might be one there. But we're going to go. But how about for you? Your friends, your family, the people around you, are they worth it? It's inconveniencing to reach them. And as we conclude, I'd like to ask you, in fact, if we just take a moment and pray right now. Let me ask you a few questions. If you bow your head and close your eyes, maybe you're here today, you happen to find yourself in church on a Monday night. And you don't know if God judged you today, if you would have a home in heaven. The Bible says, if you call on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved. We'd love to today help you do that. You can do that right where you're seated. You tell Jesus you know you're a sinner. You ask him to forgive you, that he's the Lord. You know that he rose from the dead, and you want to follow him. But likely there are many others in here. If you just consider your own self, how about your message? When you get the chance to preach, have you compromised your gospel for something else? Maybe there are others today that you need to see the call, that you need to go. You see the field. You sense that God wants to use you in some way, but you've got to be proven in training. Maybe you just need to be faithful. Maybe you need to think about your family right now. How could I go if my family's still not where it needs to be? God, would you help your people? Tonight, each person, God, would you give them a step to take towards reaching others, towards sharing the gospel, towards your call on their life? God, I pray you bless them in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's continue in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we meditate on what we've heard and we think about these things, Lord, we just pray, God, that we would do the next right step. Lord, if you've called some here today to be saved, Lord, we pray they would be saved. We pray, God, that you would encourage your saints and your word to accomplish the mission and address the items in our lives that need to be addressed that would hinder us from accomplishing your will of leading people to Christ. Lord, thank you for this message. We pray your blessing on it in Jesus' name. Amen. Man, what a good night it's been, and what a good conference it's been. Thank you, Thomas, and thank you for just being here, and Amber for enduring hardness last week. I was thinking about your guys' schedule, and just to get here was pretty, you know, that was a lot, because I'm watching the Easter activities and stuff. They're up in Portland, and then they're still up in Portland, and then I'm like, you're driving an RV. Oh, my goodness. So, man, praise the Lord, and thanks for bringing it tonight. Right where we are, and as a church, I mean, we're taking it to the streets. We're adopting the street. We're going out, and if you've been paying attention tonight to the messages that we've been hearing, God's speaking to us. He's telling HBF a few things that we need to pay attention to, and I was just thinking back on what Alex said as well. Will we go all the way, even death? Will we forsake Ishmael for the promise? I mean, he's asking us these questions. And then, man, Thomas comes right behind him. And after that, by the way, Mary Webster, where's she at? Thank you. That's great. Another example of, yeah, that was good. You know, that young lady, not Mary, she was portraying, you know, she goes to the field and loses her, I believe it was her brother, was Nate, right? And the mission cost them a lot. And she didn't quit. She kept on going until the 90s. She had to bring the fella, I forget his name, escaped me right now, from Ocala down, you know, and continue on against his will. He had to answer the call later in life. And so, I mean, it's just what God's called us to do. And then, of course, tonight, man, don't expect to take the gospel to Harrisonville or Cass County or to your imagined ministry position, right, without opposition. And don't forget the little ones, right? Don't forget the weakest, supposedly weakest among us, because those are the ones the devil's going to attack. And man, is all that in order? Those are sober words. But you know what? They're good words, because we have a good God and we have a good gospel message, and we are the salt and the light. We are the pillar and the ground of truth. I mean, man, guys, if you don't appreciate what God is doing, you may feel like, well, I'm just some old, we don't have blue collar. That's about 30 miles north. That's where I'm from. This is redneck, brother. And so... he said blue. He was hitting all the things. Boom, 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 boom. He's playing it, man. And he said blue collar. I'm like, oh no, that's redneck down here. And so I had to learn that. That's my missionary experience from coming down here. I thought it was exactly the same, but I learned it wasn't. But you might even have to give up the redneck way, right? And you might have to grow a handlebar mustache. I don't know. But whatever God calls you to do, you just got to say, God, here am I, send me, right? Continue in diligence. It takes diligence to get where God wants us to go, but we also got to grow in faithfulness, right? We got to continue in diligence and grow in faithfulness. And when we started the year off, we looked at Jeremiah, man, he did what God told him to do, and yet God did more than he even thought. Right? He went beyond that. And then he turns it around. And the man who said, God, is there anything too hard for you? He says, hey, is there anything too hard for me? You know, just blowing the Jeremiah away. in the most difficult circumstances. And boy, what a message. We just talked a little bit this morning, touched on the fact that, you know, you can go all the way to the top seat of power in this country and come to find out that isn't going to do anything. And where's it come right back to? To little old country churches and cornfields and cow fields. And people just willing to put on their boots and just go out and do what Jesus told us to do. Go ye therefore. Man, guys, God's talking to us. I'm excited about it. And I'm excited about all that God's doing in our life. So I got to wrap it up because time's out, right? So good night tonight. We are, as of this moment, over halfway through, believe it or not, with our sessions on Monday night. We only have tomorrow morning, tomorrow night, and Wednesday night left. And so, man, go home, get some rest, meditate on everything that God said. Be here in the morning, 8 o'clock breakfast, and then our sessions start. So you'll want to be here for that. Tomorrow, Thomas is up, and you're going to want to hear about some church planning. And and then also Andy Summers is going to be here, and he's going to give us some insights on how we do stewardship. And so you're going to want to be here for that. So let's stand together and stretch our legs. Grab someone from Mama, thank them, love on them, tell them to go home, get some sleep, and man, enjoy your evening together. Steve Fleshman, can you come up and pray us out? Steve has been busy this week. He has been working behind the scenes, setting up tables, tearing down tables, getting things going, and appreciate all that you've been doing and putting into this thing, just quietly behind the scenes. Just pray us out tonight, brother. Yeah.
Father, we're truly humbled by what we've heard tonight. Thank you for each of these men. Thank you for their families, their children, their wives. Lord, have your good hand upon them as they go into the uttermost, Father. And Lord, prick our hearts, stir our minds, stir our wills, strengthen our resolve, strengthen our backbone. Lord, keep us healthy and fit for the journey ahead. And just thank you for what you're doing at this conference. Thank you for Pastor Brian, just the vision he has. And Lord, it's great to be part of what you're doing here, and give us sweet sleep tonight and bring us back tomorrow. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
One thing, I'm sorry. Hey, real quick, before we leave, one quick thing I forgot to mention. Sorry, it fell out of my mind. The Bonnesons and the Yoders left. They're